Now, we have our junior church moment, or our all-age talk, and we're going to be continuing with our game of Jenga. If any of the young folks want to join me up front, you're very welcome to do so. Anyone up for a game of Jenga? We've got one. Two. I know as things go, we'll usually reach a critical mass and then the rest will come as well. You want to come up and play some Jenga? Okay. All right, so we've been busy with thinking about things. You can come up there and stand next to Lenore. Okay, good. So we've got, we've been talking about the ways in which community is built up or broken down, and we are representing that with this block, this stack of blocks that we have here. Now, last week we had hearing and listening. Now, we put hearing and listening into the stack because hearing and listening are things which strengthen a community. That's things that make us strong. Now, today we're going to be taking away something and replacing it. So looking at this block, can you see anywhere where there is some sort of weak point? Something that's not as it should be? Anyone? In the middle, over here. Okay. Do you not think this little block here is a little bit peculiar and precarious as it's balanced there? So this one that says power. Now, what do we mean if we say power? Power is things that we think give us power over other people. If we're in a big position, like a minister, or if you're a school teacher, or if you are in positions of power, the first minister in government, we see a lot of it. And unfortunately, what sometimes happens with power is people abuse power. They use it to get their own way, and they use it to manipulate other people. So do you think the way it's balanced there, is it strengthening or weakening our stack? Weakening. Good. It's not good. So we're going to replace it with something. We're going to replace power with something that will give it stability. Now we've got one here that says what? Respect. Now respect is when we know that we might disagree about something. And instead of using my power to make you see things the way I see them, or to make you do the things I want you to do, I respect you. And when I respect you, I do not exercise my power over you. And this is something that will make a community strong. So which one of you is going to take out that one and put in this one? Will you put it in? Take it out. Okay? Good. So we're taking out power. Good. Will you put in respect for us in that block there? Okay? Can come up. There we go. Move it up a bit to this side. Just so it's good. Thank you. You can just put that one down there. So we've taken out power and we've replaced it with respect. So the things that make community strong is when instead of misusing or abusing our power over other people, we respect them for who they are and what they stand for. Now, I've got something else to show you. And this is, of course, our demonstration. Now, how often do you guys go to the shops? Often? Do you go to the shops with Granny sometimes? Okay, and do you have an idea of what things cost? More or less. I found when I perhaps when I was your age, I had an idea, but when I was your age, I had no idea what things cost. I just told my mom, when she said she didn't have money to buy something, I just told her, well, go to the bank. Because we thought that the bank had an endless supply of money, of course, and if mom went to the bank, she got more money and we can buy more stuff. not knowing that you had to earn it. So I'm going to put some things on the table and you guys can tell me, and please, in the audience, you're also welcome to participate. Is this microphone dying? Test. Or is it just the mask? Can everybody hear me at least? Good. So I'm going to put some items on the table and then you can tell me if you're able to guess which one is the most valuable. Okay. What have we got there? Peanut butter. Do you like peanut butter? Hands up who likes peanut butter. Oh, there's a few people. Could I perhaps bother someone? I think the battery's running out of the mic. Could we perhaps just get a spare battery in the vestry? I usually have one in my pocket, but I forgot it this morning. So we have peanut butter. Okay, the next item. What's that? Come on, you know this. An apple. That's right. Okay. Then I've got a pen. That's it. Thanks, Rob. If you just put it down, I'll put it back in just now. Thank you. We've got a pen and something else stationery related. Stapler. Okay. And then I've got one of these. Does anybody own pets? A dog. Oh, do you? Do you have a dog? Okay. And how do you clean his teeth? Well, what we use is we usually buy some of these to give to Levi, who's our dog. And when he chews on this, it cleans his teeth. So he'll be very upset to know that I've taken away his treats. And then I've got this. What does this look like? Chewing gum. But it doesn't seem like there's any chewing gum inside. Can you hear anything? Okay. So, looking at these items, which one of them would you rather have? Which one is more valuable? Anybody in the audience want to take a guess? Which one is more valuable? The? You'll have to speak up, I can't hear. The stapler. Okay, hands up, who thinks the stapler is the most valuable? Okay. Any other guesses? The pen. Who thinks the pen is more valuable? It is a really nice pen. What if we looked inside? Which one would you rather not have? The chewing gum, because it looks, you know, you can't hear any chewing gum inside. It's quite light. And of course, the outside's all scratched and the paper's gone off of it, so it really isn't looking very nice. Would you want to have this? You've caught on to what's happening here, haven't you? So let's see what happens when we look inside. Which one is more valuable now? Anybody still want some chewing gum? Now, if we look at these things and we talk about their value, sometimes when we look at people, we look at them the same way. We look at their outside and we decide, is this person worth my time? Is this person worth my attention? Is this person worth my caring for them or giving something to them? So although these are just things, sometimes you do it with people as well. But what we forget is it's not what's on the outside that matters. It's what's on the inside. It's what's happening inside a person. It's not judging, as the saying goes, a book by its cover, but realizing what's happening inside and who that person is inside and doing what? Respecting them. So today, we're going to be listening about how we're not supposed to be judging other people on their appearance and how we are going to listen to the writings of James and what he said about that. Now, before we do that, all our school age friends, we have some crafts for you again at the back that you can do. So what we're going to be doing today is you're going to be making glasses or spectacles. So spectacles, what do we do with spectacles? You've got a lovely pair here. And do you need them to see properly? Yes, you do. Now, what would happen if I made markings on your spectacle glasses? Would you be able to see very well? No, you wouldn't. Now, we're going to be talking about how we look at people. So you're going to be making spectacles out of cardboard, and you're going to be pasting lenses onto them, colored lenses, and you can make it as intricate and as weird and wonderful as you want, and you can come show us afterwards. And if you're finished with that, you can also make a wee t-shirt. So there's t-shirt shapes that you can cut out, and the idea is to write a slogan on them as to what a slogan about not judging people by the way they look and the way they come across. So you're welcome to go and do that. So you're welcome, all our younger friends, you're welcome to go to the back now, and we will be starting with those crafts. Good, thank you. You can go along to the back if you want to do some crafts while I replace a battery. Testing 1, 2. Is that better? Good. So as our younger friends have moved to the back to go and do some crafts, let's listen to our children's prayer for this morning. God, maker, creator, life giver, soul saver, Jesus is your word made flesh. He taught us your word, the word of love and the word of service. We are sorry that we abuse the word. Forgive us when we fail to use kind words, healing words, when we look at people from the outside and not from the inside. Help us to trust in your word and to use our words wisely. Amen. Hymn 260, Eternal Father, Strong to Save. Let us pray. Mighty God, King of kings, Lord of hosts, how hard it is, indefinable and unnameable, for us to know what to call you. We want a title that will show our respect without taking us out of the upside-down world of the kingdom that Jesus came to establish, and back into the oppressive hierarchies of this world to which he was so utterly exposed. Have we fallen down a rabbit hole or stepped through the looking glass when we hear of children sitting in the seats of power, beggars and street urchins attending a royal wedding, not as waiters or kitchen staff, but as honored guests, while the king himself kneels down and washes their feet? Our brother, our companion, the servant king, no names or titles can capture it all. Not for nothing did you tell Moses, "Don't worry about my name, I just am." So perhaps we should simply be quiet for a moment or two and sit in the wonderful mystery of your being and let it fill and surround us. Holy Lord, you value people for who they are, not how much they possess. You notice the invisible ones. You hear the silent ones. You see the potential in those who have long since written themselves off as worthless. You shower compassion on those who have been most harshly judged, and you judge the powerful and privileged by how much compassion they show. Forgive us, gracious God, for every failure to see or to listen or to care. Flood us with your mercy and your grace. And perhaps when we can start becoming what you have called us to be, your eyes, your ears, your hands, your feet and your heart in this world that you made and have never stopped loving. Hear us as we add to this as a community of faith, our voices in unison praying the prayer your Son Jesus had taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So as we are dedicating the guild today, we have our convener for our guild, Catherine, who is going to be reading for us first this morning, and she's going to be reading from James chapter 2, verses 1 to 17. Thank you, Catherine.
Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing an old ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in shabby clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, "Here's a good seat for you," but say to the poor man, "You stand there or sit on the floor by my feet," have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my dear brothers. Has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have insulted the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are slandering the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbour as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. For he who said, "Do not commit adultery," also said, "Do not murder." If you do not commit adultery but do commit murder, you have become a lawbreaker. Speak and act as those who are giving to be judged by the law that gives freedom. Because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to him, "Go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed," but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself is not accompanied by action is dead. Amen.
Hymn 557, O love that will not let me go.
Jesus said to her, "Because of that answer, go back home, where you will find that the demon has gone out of your daughter." She went home and found her child lying on the bed. The demon had indeed gone out of her. Thanks be to God for these readings from his holy word. Amen.
A long, long time ago, somewhere in the East, A man was traveling with his donkey between two towns. The man was a successful rice salesman, and he used his donkey to carry two big bags of rice on each side. It was mercilessly hot and a very humid day. The man and the donkey became very tired. He saw a tree covering a patch of grass next to a stream and decided to rest there. He tied the donkey to the tree and lay down under the cool shadow of the tree. A little while later, he woke up and couldn't find his donkey. He set off in the direction of the nearest village, where he encountered a young boy. The boy was quite dirty and dressed in very old, worn and torn clothes. He was obviously very poor. The man asked him if he had seen his donkey. The boy asked, "Is it a crippled donkey, carrying rice with a blind left eye?" "That's him," said the man. "Where is he?" "I have not seen him," said the boy. The man became furious. How could this boy describe this donkey so perfectly and pretend not to have seen him? He must have stolen him and the rice too. He took the boy by the arm and marched into the nearest town to see the village elders. The lead elder asked the boy if he had stolen the donkey, to which the emotional boy answered that he hadn't. When asked how he was able to describe the donkey so accurately without having seen him, the boy answered, "On my way into town, I noticed donkey tracks in the dirt road, but saw that one of his front feet were dragging, so I assumed that he had injured his one foot and was dragging it in the dirt. I also saw rice along the road, so I assumed he was carrying rice. I also noticed that the grass on the right-hand side of the road was being eaten, but not on the left, and assumed that the donkey was blind in his left eye." The elders dismissed the boy and reprimanded the man for assuming that the boy had stolen his donkey based on his appearance and obviously very excellent deductive skills. Now, we all know that judging people is not something new. It has perhaps become more apparent with the dawn of social media, but judging people based on their appearance, their accent, their skin color, their habits or actions is not new. It has been around for as long as humans have. Even in the Bible, there are instances where the writers of certain books and letters had to address it. In our first reading from James, James is writing to the readers of his letter that people should stop judging their fellow believers and strangers on their appearance. James states that judging others on their outward appearance is in direct opposition of the law requiring us to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. James states that in judging others, you bring God's judgment on yourself. I read this and wondered by myself, could this be another way of saying that when we judge others about the way they walk, the way they talk, the way they dress, the way they look, does it perhaps say more about us than it does about them? James, his words in verse 13 are beautiful to me. And if I had to take one sentence out of that reading, it would be in verse 13 where he said, "But mercy triumphs over judgment." He is saying that the power of mercy is stronger than that of judgment. This is something which is also illustrated by Jesus in the gospel reading. While seated at the table, a Gentile woman, who the Jews would often call dogs as a judgment on their perceived ritual uncleanliness, came sitting at his feet begging him to heal her daughter. Jesus uses the age-old slur for Gentiles when saying, "Let us first feed the children. It isn't right to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." I think in our day, if someone were to say something like that to a guest at a dinner table, we would all be, "Did that person just say that? Could it be?" But the people around Jesus were used to using that kind of language for a Gentile. We would expect the woman to be so offended by this that she would storm off in a fit of rage. But she accepts this judgment and still avails her to Jesus' mercy by answering, "Even the dogs under the table eat the children's leftovers." Mercy triumphs when Jesus answers her request and heals her daughter. Mercy is stronger than judgment. Mercy takes on many forms. Mercy is shown when we make effort to help a person who does not own decent clothes to buy some, rather than laugh at them with our friends. Mercy is reaching out to our friend with a drinking problem to say that we are there for him, rather than wag our tongues about them when talking to the neighbors. Mercy is making the effort to get to know my foreign neighbor rather than spread my assumptions about them or their culture. Mercy is providing bread to all who are hungry rather than berate them for being lazy or not being able to hold onto a job. Mercy is pulling the outsider into our inner circles, feeding the dogs at the table rather than allowing them to simply have the scraps, as Jesus so eloquently put it. When our capacity for mercy increases, we might even find that we become more merciful with ourselves. We not only judge others, but we quite often judge ourselves very harshly as well. The healing power of mercy in allowing others to be without judging them to some self-made norm frees us too to be ourselves, to believe that we are worthy of being loved by God and by others. And being loved not for being the smartest, richest, bravest, or most beautiful, but because we were created by Him. Mercy is most active when we place ourselves in someone else's shoes to realize that they too are doing the best they can with the opportunities they have had and where they come from. May mercy untie our hands and close our mouths so that we can help rather than judge. As today we dedicate the Guild for their work in the coming year, I'm inspired by the Guild's theme for the last 3 years, which was the extra mile. And this was based on the words of Jesus in Matthew 5, verse 41, where he says, "And if someone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. It is about being on the road with people and supporting them. It is about mercy, traveling with others without stopping to think about whether they are worth it or not, whether they deserve it or not, without stopping to think about what others will think about us when they see us with them. It's about striving to be a companion for all. It's not about power. It is about respect. Creating a space where there is no space for judgment, but endless room for mercy. Of course, all organizations, including the church, is made up of people. And as people, we often fail with the best of intentions. But as we dedicate the work of the Guild here in our community, let this be our prayer for our community, our church, people who attend the Guild, to experience mercy, a place to travel with all and not count the miles. Mercy which will allow us to look forward in faith, which is of course the theme for the next 3 years. Amen. Let's listen to our voluntary as we reflect on our readings and prayers. We do our final prayer for all the members of the Guild to stand as we pray for them and their work as well. Holy God, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Your disciples asked you one day. They should have known better by then, Lord. You took a little child, placed her where everyone could see her, and said, "Here is your answer." What do I have to do to join your kingdom? A young man asked you one day, Lord. Not in a million years could he have guessed the answer. All your cards, all your cash, oh, and that big portfolio of investments, you answered. You need to get rid of them. Lord, what do you expect of us? It was good religious people who asked the question. Do some of the rules matter more than others? Love God, you said, and love your neighbor as much as you love yourself. Living God, it is so simple and so very, very hard. No way can we do it on our own. Help us to get our priorities sorted out, and if we're ever in any doubt about what it all means, who's right and who's wrong, maybe go back to the default of loving one another as you have loved us. Holy God, as we use this day and this moment to think about the work of the Guild, we reflect on the theme for this year, or for the years past, the extra mile. We thank you for the tireless work of the Guild all over Scotland and especially here in our own community. We thank you for sustaining this group of friends to be not only friends to each other, but to all who need company on the road. Whatever form this may take for people, thank you that we can entrust this important work to your care as they begin meeting again after a long pause during the pandemic. We send them to do your work and dedicate the Guild to your care for another year. As we pray and send them out to look forward in faith, with the words of St. Francis of Assisi. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, not so much to be understood as to understand, not so much to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive ourselves, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying to ourselves that we awake to eternal life. Amen. You may take your seats. Thank you very much. Now, my friends there in the back of the church, how are things coming along there? Have you hit a snag in the making of the glasses? You're good to go. Okay, so do you guys want to come up front and show us some of your glasses, please? Or your spectacles, sorry, I'm using the wrong word. Giving away that I'm a foreigner. So, can we have our spectacled friends come and show us what you've made? And if you've got your t-shirts made as well as you've gotten so far, you're welcome to bring that along with you too. Wow, I see some very stylish specs. Oh, wow. Look at that one. Oh, show it to the people. What color is those are those lenses? They're orange. Okay. So what's going to happen if you've got blue ones and you've got a blue frame. And let's see yours. Oh, you kept them white on that side and on the other side? Oh, you've got the lenses pasted on there. Well, let's see if you can put it on. Can you put it on? Okay, and if you have a look at the people around you, what do they look like? Do they look blue? I can promise you they're not blue. Perhaps after such a heavy sermon, they might feel a little down, but I won't call them blue. Are they blue? They look blue. And if you take off your spectacles, they look normal. Now, James tells us in the Bible that when we look at other people, it all depends on which lens we look through at them. The people are blue because the lenses that you've got in your spectacles are blue. And James tells us that when we look at other people, we need to take down our own lenses and we need to put on God's lenses. We need to put on God's spectacles when we look at other people. How do you think God sees other people? Does he see them as awful people, naughty people? Do you think that's how God sees people? No. How does he see people? Do you think? Good, kind, lovely people. We know that because we know that Jesus died for us, so we must be worth something then, at least. We're actually worth a lot. So we need to put on our spectacles, God's spectacles, to see people the way he sees them. So let me read you what James said. We read it earlier, but I'm going to read you another version of what he said. So this is in the form of a letter from James, a servant of God and Jesus, to the Jewish Christian community scattered around Jerusalem. Hello again, my brothers and sisters. Today I want you to think about favoritism, and I have some questions for you. Ask yourselves, how do you judge people? By their clothes, their accent, their job, their possessions? What do you do if a person with gold rings and fine clothes come to you in a meeting? Do you show them the best seat? And what do you do when a person who has dirty clothes and is obviously poor comes in? Do you show them the worst seat? Or suggest they sit on the floor? Do you favor those who look poor or rich? You ought to know by now that God favors the poor and makes them rich, rich in faith, as full heirs of God's kingdom. Remember, we are taught to love our neighbors, all our neighbors. Keep the law, don't twist it. And you are not to make distinction between your faith and your actions. You need faith, my brothers and sisters, but you need action too. It's not no good telling people to go in peace, keep warm and eat well if they have no food or shelter. If someone is hungry, they need food. If they are cold, they need warm clothes and a warm house. It's obvious what you have to do. Enough for today. Be fair, be generous. More next week, James. So next week we will be listening at what James has to say again next week, and then we will be building forth on our community stack as we have it here next week. Thank you guys for coming this morning. Okay, you can go back to your seats as we prepare to sing together hymn 528, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace. Loved and challenged, go in the beauty of God the Maker, go in the love of Jesus the Healer, and go in the challenge of the Holy Spirit to go love and serve.